What's up, you guys? It's Ben, and welcome back to my channel where we talk about everything there is relating to selling on Amazon. So for today's video, I want to talk to you about taxes. Now, understand, it's probably not going to be the most exciting or the most popular subject out there. However, us business owners, we need to know everything there is in relation to bookkeeping, accountancy, VAT, corporation tax, and various other things. At the end of the day, we need to know what is coming in and out of our business to make sure we make the best possible business decisions and we understand if we actually are making any profit or not by selling various products on Amazon. And to do this and to answer all of these questions around accountancy, I brought in Taimur, who is the head accountant at Awesome, one of the lead e-commerce accountants in UK at the moment. And if you are interested in using them, please don't forget to check the links down below for my referral link. With that being said, let's get straight to the video. All right, so Taimur, the first question I wanted to ask for you today is, when do you actually need an accountant? As so many of our FBA Amazon sellers, so to speak, they start off a business, they're looking to sell on Amazon, they're looking for product research and stuff. But one thing that I personally think they kind of completely neglect is the tax side, is the accountancy side of things. You being the expert, from your perspective, honestly, when do you think people should start thinking about taxes, accountancy, and so on?
I completely agree that accountancy is normally at the very back end of your thought process when you're looking into your business and, you know, trying to decide what business you should go for. There are three aspects to it. The first one is the finances, how much it does it cost you, the value that it brings out, and the legal aspect of it. So the finances, again, going to an accountant from day one or going to an accountant at the very last day when your accounts are due, which one is better? Finance-wise, doing from beginning is much easier because your accountant gets a whole year to do your accounts. So they won't charge you any premium. They will charge you their normal rates.
Yeah.
If you go to an accountant just before your deadlines, not only they will charge you for doing all of your bookkeeping in one go, they will also charge you premium because they have to do the whole thing in one go. So finance-wise, it's not better to leave things for the last minute because you will need an accountant regardless to do your taxes. Yeah. So having it from day one makes more sense because it's cheaper in a sense.
Okay.
And you divide the money over the month and you pay them monthly fees rather than paying one bulk at the end of the year, like, you know, a few thousand pounds.
Yeah.
So finances wise, you know, that makes more sense. In terms of value, what it provides you in return, if you have someone there as a partner to you who does your bookkeeping on a regular basis, like we promise day-to-day bookkeeping, what you get is a really up-to-date understanding of your business finances.
Yeah.
You know how much you have sold on a regular basis. You know how much it costs you to sell those items.
Yeah.
How much admin costs your businesses. So you get those management reports that you can use to make viable decisions. You might be selling a really high profitable or high sellable item, but is it actually profitable or not? You can only know if your books are done.
Yeah.
You might think you're buying something for £15 from Alibaba, selling it for 20, you're making £5, but there's admin cost. So you actually don't know how much you're doing until unless you do the work. And if your accountant is doing from day one, you would know your stuff from day one.
Yeah.
And the last part is the legal aspect of it. Again, HMRC requires you to store all of your data for your finances for 5 years at least.
Mm-hmm.
If you have an accountant and you're sending them all the invoices on a regular basis, that will get stored on their database like we do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Which means that compliance-wise, you've done your job.
Yeah.
So, like, even if I think about it, I've spent something 3 months ago, and I've spent a 100 of different items.
Yeah.
I wouldn't remember by now, 3 months, 4 months down the line, that what those invoices were, where they are. You know, it gets a bit messy. So it's really good to have them, because that's a compliance matter from day one. So based on those three things, I would say that get an accountant as soon as you're comfortable that your business is something that will go on for long and you would need an accountant at the end of it.
See, I agree with you with the second and the third part, because obviously on the second part, it's very easy to think you're making profit because of all these additional fees, storage fees, advertising fees, and various other things that come with Amazon FBA. You can easily realize that, hey, you're making money, you're selling things, but you're actually going in a deeper hole, so to speak. So having that backup and that financial advisor, so to speak, in the form of an accountant is really, really helpful. What I find quite interesting that you say is that, so you're telling me it works out cheaper to have an accountant from day one as opposed to having an accountant, let's say, when your VAT returns are due, so to speak, because then that's when you employ them and that's when you have actually start paying, so to speak. So it's actually cheaper to pay monthly from the very beginning as opposed to one big lump sum later on.
Yes, so imagine if you come to me and you're coming literally 5 days before your bad deadline.
Yeah.
Right. So the two things are going to happen. I'm either going to say, I'm sorry, I'm too busy. I have 30 other deadlines, so I won't be able to take you on. Or I'm going to say, yes, I'll put extra resources on. So normally I would have charged you £240. Today I'm going to charge you £320, £100 extra, whatever.
Yeah.
Because I will be doing extra hours, out of working hours to do that. And that's how majority of the accountancy firm works, until unless someone is, you know, very... they're small businesses and they just want to get clients, they will probably give you a discount. But majority of the well-established accounting firm will charge you a bit of a premium to do that. Compared to someone, you know, you'd go to an accountant and you become the regular client and they will just do it on normal price. So that's basically the practice of how it works. And that goes for same for payroll, accounting. You know, you're going to an accountant after 12 months worth of bookkeeping. And that accountant now needs to do all of the 12 months worth of book in one go.
Yeah.
Like in probably 2 weeks or 3 weeks, whenever the deadline is. And that's, you know, they charge you extra for that.
Yeah, no, I completely understand and I agree with that. So what's interesting with me is that when I was looking for an accountant quite a few years ago, a lot of accountants were used to restaurant type businesses, construction, garages, so to speak. But every single time I spoke to them about Amazon FBA or e-commerce in general, I spent over half an hour explaining to them what the business actually is. And to me, that was a bad sign, because if my accountant doesn't even know the basics of what I do as a business, they're probably not going to be the right accountant. What makes e-commerce so unique in today's world in comparison to other businesses from an accountancy perspective?
It's a big difference. And it's a difference that not everyone understands, because e-commerce has been there for a very long time, but it's now when it's at its peak and everyone is getting involved into it.
Finally, yes.
The things that differs, like from a bigger picture, the VAT situation is completely different.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at it, HMRC has their VAT guidance for how businesses work.
Yeah.
But for e-commerce specifically, they have a whole section on its own. Because e-commerce VAT is different. It involves all import VAT, custom charges, and cross-border changes. Now, Brexit happened, right? One of the main areas that there was a big change was e-commerce.
Yeah.
And the reason, again, e-commerce was highlighted is because there's so much VAT implications involved in it. Whenever you cross a border, there will be a VAT implication to it. And there is a reason why government focuses on e-commerce nowadays as well. Like Europe is now issuing new rules from 1st of July for e-commerce businesses.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just by looking at this tells you that e-commerce segment itself is a very different and has very specific treatment of products in a very different way. And, you know, governments are making efforts to make sure that it's understandable for everyone. But to talk about very specific items, as I mentioned, import VAT is one of the big elements. Even the VAT within the UK, if you're selling it online, there's a shipment cost involved in it.
Yeah.
One of the most common things that I've heard from my existing client that their previous accountant didn't know is, if they're selling goods zero rated or 20% VAT, they also charge shipment cost. What rate should be the shipment cost? Should they be on VAT or not? Dropshipper businesses, you know, they get confused that the threshold is £85,000, but that's not right. When you bring the good into the UK at the point of sale, you need to be registered from day one. For VAT. So basically the compliances and the legal aspects of things and the bookkeeping is completely different from what a normal trading business is. And that's where you need to differentiate. There's so many different types of e-commerce business, arbitrage, dropshipping, personal branding, and all of them have different VAT treatment and accounting treatment.
Yeah.
So that's why e-commerce is unique and you need someone very specialized in it to understand it.
Yeah, no, I completely understand. And how, from your experience, I mean, given that you guys are e-commerce accountant experts, you know, this is what you do day in and day out. How have e-commerce businesses in general been affected by COVID, by Brexit? Has it been something positive, net positive, or has it been net negative for them?
So apart from accounting side of things, like a general perspective, COVID helped e-commerce.
Yeah.
And it's not a good thing to say, but I was reading an article the other day which said that COVID has pushed e-commerce at least 6 to 7 years in advance. So the position we are in now, we would have probably seen this 5-6 years later. But because of COVID-19, it's literally happening now. So in terms of the business prospect and e-commerce and competition, all of that has literally went on a height overnight because of COVID. And I've seen personal examples that where, so, you know, again, I can't take names and stuff, but
yeah, of course.
Some of my clients, they were laid off from their job. They were not happy. They obviously, you know, it was a time of depression because, you know, it's source of income. They started their e-commerce business, and within 3-4 months, you know, they were making more than they could have made on their normal working hours. So yeah, from COVID, I think a lot positive came out compared to negative for e-commerce side of things. Brexit, however, is a completely different story. Before, a UK e-commerce business had a biggest market available to them at their doorstep. Well, a single market, anyone from Europe could have bought anything from a UK buyer. Amazon FBA was a big part of it. Pan-EU worked really well. Now there is a big line in between. And as you know, it's much worse to keep on selling in EU than just hold on and understand it first. Again, another article that I read initially in January, that 30% of UK goods that were sold to Europe in January were sent back. And big retailers in UK were at a point of deciding that should they just leave it at the custom, get them burned, or do whatever with them, but not get them back, because bringing them back meant crossing the border again and paying all of those charges. It was more expensive to get them back. So 30% of the goods were lost in an essence. That's how bad Brexit basically made this whole situation. But now everyone has got a good grip of it, and in the new EU rules are working well for the e-commerce side of things as well.
Yeah.
So in an essence, COVID was good, Brexit was bad, but now things are getting into shape.
I'm one of those 30%, to be completely honest, because once I've actually realized how much is going to cost all of these small niche products that are under £10 to be brought back, it's just the whole profit margin is taken off. And then if I do bring them back, I will just basically be spending, well, selling them at break even. There's just no point effectively, because then you have to bring in VAT charges on it and so on and so forth. COVID, on the other hand, just like when I speak to my students all the time, it's been devastating for a lot of businesses, but e-commerce and just online businesses in general, any business that I think had a good presence online benefited from it. And it doesn't even need to be e-commerce. It can be any online business, even food delivery businesses, takeaways. Those have been benefiting tremendously because of the aspect you can get it from home, so to speak. But what I found interesting is that now this is where the new sellers that have just started selling during COVID are really panicking, because now that lockdown is kind of finishing and the sales are tapering down a little bit, they are panicking quite tremendously, because all of a sudden you go from selling 30 products a day to selling 10, you know, because everybody's outside, everybody's in the high street retail shops and so on and so forth. And then you all of a sudden get these questions, is this going to last and so on? But I do believe, like you said, I think it's going to pick back up. I think e-commerce and especially Amazon has been pushed forward quite a few years, because people now have these habits, know the convenience of how easy it is to get something in at your doorstep by the next day. Like, why do you have to shop around and stuff when you can just order it online so quickly? And they've experienced it. And this is why Amazon is hiring, I think, another 100,000 employees in the next half a year. It speaks for itself, really. So it brings me on to my next question. Given that Amazon FBA has exploded last year in terms of the customer side, it's also exploded on the seller side. There's been so many new sellers. I mean, from my own experience, so many new students have been brought on over the last few months. Any advice, any sort of tips, so to speak, or any best practices you would tell people who are literally just starting off, don't want to mess up their accounts, don't want to, you know, dump everything at the very last minute or to the accountant, anything that they can do to help themselves for the future?
There's a very interesting question, because it is hard to explain what I'm going to say is important and why it is important, but it is important. And
yeah.
I've seen a lot of my clients doing this and making those wise business decisions. Now,
yeah.
Obviously, as you are, you know, you're a coach yourself, you probably know that it's a very, e-commerce is quite approachable by anyone. So one really good thing about e-commerce is that anyone can do it. So it does not restrict you. You do not have to have an education or degree for it.
Yeah.
You know, anyone can get into it. But what it does is that you have to understand how it works in depth to actually make anything out of it.
Yeah.
So buying goods and just selling them, it's not that simple. You have to understand that what you've bought and how much you bought it for. And when you're selling it, you have to understand the strategy and analysis behind it and understand if it's going to make you any money at the end of it or not.
Yeah.
And you do that by having a good bookkeeping for it. So imagine you bought something for £15. Again, you're selling it for £20. You record all of your other costs. And once you do that, you know, like everything else included is an extra £2 for that product. You have a margin of £3 in that specific product that you can use for competitive edge, discounts, and, you know, promotions and stuff.
Yeah.
What a lot of people don't do is don't do this calculation, and they just, you know, for better competition, they just offer anything and then start losing money than making money. And you wouldn't realize this unless you actually see your month-end report or you know, your 6 months report. You don't actually see the effect of it. You just see sales coming in.
Yeah.
So the best, one of the best advice that I can give is to have your books up to date, make a habit of it. Once a week, at least as a minimum, do your books and see how your business is doing in financial terms. Understand your business. You know, make your business a journey that needs to be understood at every step of it, rather than just, you know, just focus on selling.
Yeah.
And once you know, then you can make good decisions. Like,
sorry, just to interrupt. On the do your book side of things, are you referring to updating Xero each and every single week to make sure you can see what the profit and loss is, or what exactly does that mean?
Sure. When I say books, I mean, you know, you have a bank account. You use one bank account. Again, that's another advice. Use a very specific business bank account. Mm-hmm. Don't use your personal account, because it mixes up and messes everything up. But you have a bank account, and in this bank account, you're spending money and you're receiving money.
Yeah.
Right. Categorize them into the right place on Xero. Yeah. So again, I'm not going to specify which accounting software. We use Xero because Xero is very compatible with e-commerce. But you can use any accounting software or your own methods that you do. But reconcile them, put the expenses into the right place. So if you've spent something on Alibaba, put it under purchases, cost of sales, marketing, put it under marketing. Mm-hmm. Do that and put your sales in a specific manner as well. You know, Europe, UK, USA, wherever you're selling them, put them in the category. Then analyze that on each month basis. Yeah. See, you know, if your market is, your product is selling good in USA, you're selling most of them there, then spend your marketing costs in USA, because that will increase your sales and obviously profitability. Yeah. So that's what I mean when I say bookkeeping is categorizing your bank transactions into the right places.
No, I understand. And to be honest, I completely agree, because I started off with no business experience whatsoever. And then once I actually started doing bookkeeping properly myself, after being taught how to do it properly, you not only understand what's going on in the business, but it also helps you forecast for the future. So if I sold a specific item, 300-400 units, you can kind of get an idea of how much I should be buying over the next 3 months, because you can buy too little, but also you can buy too much and then overspend on storage costs and so on, which was one of the biggest mistakes I've done in quite a while ago. And that brings me on to my next question. Now, given e-commerce is so different to pretty much any other usual business out there, what can be claimed as expenses exactly? Because I when I started off, I did not know. So I wanted to make sure I claimed pretty much everything. And I'm talking the petrol, I'm talking the phone bills, I'm talking potentially the mortgage, I'm talking everything. I want to know exactly what can be categorized as a business expense and what you should stay away from categorizing it.
Sure. I think to start with a very simple and overall logic of it is that anything that you spend because of your business, and you wouldn't have spent this money if you weren't doing this business.
Yeah.
So for example, if you have a mobile phone and you're using your mobile phone a lot because, you know, you're making calls, you're speaking to people on Alibaba, then one mobile phone is allowed as an expense for the business, not more than one. The second one becomes a benefit. You're using your car for Amazon arbitrage. You're going to different retailers and using your petrol. So mileage, claim all the mileage back. If you're in your home and you have made a warehouse and there's a separate room, which is one third of your house now, you can claim the portion of that. Your bills have gone up, you know, because of your electricity and all of that. You can use the increased portion of your bills. So anything that directly links to the business can be claimed back. There are some things that you can also, for example, entertainment, which is food for yourself. Yeah. So if you're going on an Amazon arbitrage and it took you a whole day and you bought food for yourself, you cannot claim that because that's food that you would have done yourself anyways. The things like if you the things that you can also claim as an extra is working from home. If that's the only condition that you don't have any other option, you can claim £6 a week from HMRC. And from if you're a limited company and from your company. So there are a lot of things that you can and cannot. The best part is to understand what specific area of e-commerce you are in and obviously use that. But all the cost of your goods, anything that you've spent, you know, all the money that you spend on Alibaba, freight charges and import VAT, all of that can be claimed back.
No, I understand. And I myself made plenty of mistakes, but what are the most common mistakes that, that new, not necessarily just FBA sellers make, but just new business people that don't have much experience? What are the common errors that you see?
Well, for financially, I would say understanding the business finances is one of those things. So what I've seen is majority of our clients who come on board, whichever platform they're working on, Shopify, Amazon, there's one common thing from all of these platforms is that they gather the money for you and then put the money in your account after an interval. So Amazon does it every 14 days. Shopify does every other day.
Yeah.
The money they put into your account, people recognize that as sales. And some of them even go to an extent where, you know, the 85,000 threshold for VAT registration, they use that money to identify that as £85,000.
Yeah.
That's not your sale. Your sale is what you actually sold on Amazon, minus all the fees, marketing commission and all of that. That's the money that you get into your bank account.
Yeah.
So one of the mistakes is to understanding what the actual sales is. Secondly, this is something that I experienced personally, is that when you're speaking to a supplier and you're trying to find out your base cost of your goods, be careful that there could be a lot of other costs involved in it. I made a mistake of thinking that that's all my cost, but there was import VAT as well that I had to pay when the goods got here. So knowing all of your cost for a specific e-commerce market is quite important to know actually if your product will be profitable or not. And the last thing I would say is to, as I mentioned before as well, to record all of this in a way that it helps you in return. A lot of people just push that to a side. But you need to understand that. So those are the few things that you need to understand. And I also, understand the market as well. So is still keep on selling on Europe is profitable for you or not? You need to understand that. And a lot of new businesses think that, you know, EU is a big market. They should, but you need to figure out the finances first.
Yeah. Well, actually, that brings me on to my next question. Given now that all the difficulties that have come around with Brexit, majority of the people watching this video are going to be based in the UK. However, would you recommend them starting in the UK or going into the EU as well? I personally say start off where you're based at. This is the easiest and it's most likely going to be your native language. I personally find it really difficult to sell and obviously to give good customer service to the likes of France, Germany, Italy, and so on and so forth. Coupled now with Brexit, this makes things even harder. Do you agree or do you think people should spread themselves across Europe and then kind of see what sells, where it sells and go concentrate on that?
Well, one thing I would say that EU is a big market.
Yeah. Right?
And limiting yourself could be detrimental where similar to your competitor is probably already achieving that market. But having said that, given all the complications that are in terms of that, and if you're just starting, stick to your specific area, conquer that first, and then try to go to a different market. Because even in UK, as soon as you hit the £85,000, you get into a realm of VAT.
Yeah,
and as soon as you get that, a lot of new complications will come in. It will not be as straightforward as just selling and buying. You have to do your VAT returns. You have to understand the cost. Do you charge extra 20% for competition, or just take a hit of 20% on your sales? There's a lot that get involved. Imagine that, and now you also have to consider VAT for different countries. Every country you sell in, you have to do VAT returns there as well. So if you're a new business, if you're starting, start local, start, see how it works for you, and then jump into, once your business is capable enough and good enough, then definitely go to Europe, because Europe is a market that you should not be depriving yourself of.
Okay, interesting. And well, now let's move on to Awesome. You guys, like I said before, and I speak on every single one of the videos, you pride yourselves of being the e-commerce experts. What can FBA sellers that are watching this video gain from joining with you guys? What can you help them out with, so to speak?
Sure. Look, unlike traditional accounting firm or a non-e-commerce firm, what we can definitely provide is the knowledge that comes with us. Majority of my clients, that we don't just do their books, and you know we just don't do their debits and credits and that's it.
Yeah.
We actually help them, consult them, understand their niche. So if you want to sell in Europe, we will make the bridges for you. So we will help you get to European market, register you for VAT, do your VAT returns there. Even inside UK, if you are, you know, you have a question about how something works in terms of accounting and bookkeeping, we know the answer because we've been studying and we've been researching for it for almost you know, years now. So we bring a big knowledge bank with us on this specific industry.
Yeah.
Then the automations. We have automated the whole process, and we continuously are doing this. We have a big tech team. More than accountants, we have more than app developers and technical individuals who are working on the app continuously and producing, making it more intellectual in terms of AI and stuff.
Yeah.
So the automation on the e-commerce platform specifically is really great on with us. Secondly, the amount of consultation you get. So we have a chat-based system where you can talk to us as many times as you want. You can write your messages, and it's literally, you have your accountants on your fingertips, basically, compared to having to book an appointment next week or a week later and then not turning over anything like that. So we get back to you within 24 hours. So those are the main three things that you get with everything else of the app and convenience and you know, all the automation.
Okay, perfect. And last question then, how do people who are potentially interested, how do they get in touch?
So if you go to the website, awesome.com, literally, and if you scroll down, there's a chat system. So our sales rep are available on the chat. And you can ring us and book a consultation with either myself or one of the other accountants. And I believe if they come through a reference of yourself, then they get referral discounts. So they can approach you. And obviously, your clients will get discounts because they're coming through your references.
And yes, of course, if you do want to join Awesome, I will leave a link down below, like I do in each and every single video. That's pretty much it for today, guys. I really hope you found it useful. Thank you so much for joining me, and we'll speak soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you.